الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين هو الذي يريكم آياته وينزل لكم من السماء رزقا وما يتذكر إلا من ينيب فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون رفيع الدرجات ذو العرش يلقي الروح من أمره على من يشاء من عباده يلقي الروح من أمره على من يشاء من عباده لينذر يوم التلاق يوم هم بارزون لا يخفى على الله منهم شيء لمن الملك اليوم الملك اليوم لله الواحد القهار لمن الملك اليوم لله الواحد القهار اليوم تجزى كل نفس بما كسبت لا ظلم اليوم إن الله سريع الحساب وأنذرهم يوم الآزفة إذ القلوب لدى الحناجر كاظمين ما للظالمين من حميم ولا شفيع يطاع يعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور والله يقضي بالحق والذين يدعون من دونه لا يقضون بشيء إن الله هو السميع البصير الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين كلا بل تحبون العاجلة وتذرون الآخرة وجوه يومئذ ناضرة إلى ربها ناظرة ووجوه يومئذ باسرة تظن أن يفعل بها فاقرة كلا إذا بلغت التراقي وقيل من راق وظن أنه الفراق والتفت الساق بالساق إلى ربك يومئذ المساق فلا صدق ولا صلى ولكن كذب وتولى ثم ذهب إلى أهله يتمطى أولى لك فأولى ثم أولى لك فأولى أيحسب الإنسان أن يترك سدى ألم يك نطفة من مني يمنى ثم كان علقة فخلق فسوى فجعل منه الزوجين الذكر والأنثى أليس ذلك بقادر على أن يحيي الموتى.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. ما شاء الله، جزاكم الله خيرا. To my dear brothers, and I also would like to thank our sisters who are also attending this lecture tonight, inshallah ta'ala. And alhamdulillah, and this is a great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to have given us the opportunity to come together in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I was just asking Ustaz Yahya, I was like just saying to him within the last 7-8 days, and how many times have we been together, like in terms of like being together in the same masjid. And this time last week, a week ago, we were together in Masjid al-Taqwa. Where's Masjid al-Taqwa? Sheffield, yes, alhamdulillah. And me and him and Ustaz Jamal and also Ustaz Yasin Munya, all of us, alhamdulillah, we were together in Masjid al-Taqwa in the city of Sheffield. And my old masjid and also my current masjid, both of them, alhamdulillah. And so Ustaz Yahya, jazahullah khairan, since last week he went back to London, we invited him, mashallah, back to Masjid al-Furqan, and alhamdulillah he's accepted our invitation and he came, mashallah, to Masjid al-Furqan. And at the same time, subhanallah, he was able to kill 2 birds with 1 stone. Alhamdulillah, he went back to the city of Sheffield last night as well. This time last night, he was actually delivering a talk and a lecture in Masjid, the Grand Masjid of Sheffield, a big masjid that was recently built in Sheffield. So, Jazahullah Khairan, look how Ustaz Yahya, alhamdulillah, he's benefiting from his time. At the same time, he's benefiting our Muslim community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him greatly. Allahumma ameen. And as you can see, he's someone who has sacrificed his time and effort and energy for the da'wah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve him. Allahumma ameen. Let me also take this opportunity to thank our dear brother Ubaid, mashallah, who's visiting our masjid for the first time, who drove the Sheikh all the way from London and then took him to Sheffield last night and then brought him back. And tonight after this lecture, he's going to take him back to London. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him greatly. Say ameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him with a righteous wife, brother Ubaid. Say ameen. I put you on the spot, brother. MashaAllah. Don't worry, inshallah. You got, look at the dua that you've got now. Alhamdulillah. Everybody made that special dua for you. And where's Brother Hamidullah? He's going to look after you, inshallah. MashaAllah. Where's Ustaz Hamidullah? Has he gone? Oh, he's not too far. MashaAllah. I told him this morning, you know. I told him, inshallah. Alhamdulillah. Barakallahu feekum. And just before we begin the reminder, inshallah ta'ala, and the talk, which is really, really important talk, a day in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we know, the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is very important to us. Why? Because he's our great example that we have to follow. Do you know, nowadays people do like to buy certain books, and they do like to find out what the life of a particular important person looks like, their life in a particular day. So just imagine what we are going to hear tonight, inshallah ta'ala, what a day used to look like in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we are all looking forward to that. But before I let the Shaykh, inshallah ta'ala, speak about this amazing topic, I would like to invite one of our students, Mumin, inshallah ta'ala, to kickstart the gathering tonight, inshallah ta'ala, with the recitation of the Quran. And our dear student, mashallah, Mumin, and he's going to recite, inshallah ta'ala, and inshallah ta'ala, some of the verses from the Quran. And I would like to welcome him. فليتفضل مشكورا. إن شاء الله تعالى, as soon as the Quran recitation finishes, automatically the talk is going to begin, إن شاء الله تعالى.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. لهم البشرى في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. لا تبديل لكلمات الله. ذلك هو الفوز العظيم. ولا يحزنك قولهم. إن العزة لله جميعا. والسميع العليم. ألا إن لله من في السماوات ومن في الأرض وما يتبع الذين يدعون من دون الله شركاء إن يتبعون إلا الظن وإن هم إلا يخرصون. هو الذي جعل لكم الليل لتسكنوا فيه والنهار مبصرا. إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يسمعون.
ما شاء الله تبارك الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. أحمده سبحانه وأشكره. ومن مساوي عملي أستغفره وأستعينه على نيل الرضا وأستمد لطفه فيما قضى. وبعد إني باليقين أشهد شهادة الإخلاص ألا يعبد بالحق مألوه سوى الرحمن من جل عن عيب وعن نقصان. وأن خير خلقه محمدا من جاءنا بالبينات والهدى رسوله إلى جميع الخلق بالنور والهدى ودين الحق صلى عليه ربنا ومجدا والآل والصحب دواما سرمدا. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبعد, والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. After praising Allah جل في علاه and sending salutations upon our messenger Muhammad alayhi salatu wassalam, we proceed. And alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, that Allah has gathered us here in his house. It is a great blessing that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he honors you with the opportunity to be in his house, worshipping him jalla wa ala, drawing closer to him, seeking His forgiveness, His mercy, His reward. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make this a blessed gathering. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who are forgiven in this gathering. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who attain His mercy. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, just like He united us here tonight, that He unites us in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la, innahu wali dhalika al-qadir alayh. Ayyuha al-ikhwa al-akhawat, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He tells in the Quran that He sent the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam to us so that He can be our example that we follow and that we imitate Him in all our affairs. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He sent messengers. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He chooses from mankind who He wishes as messengers from His creation. He sent messengers from the angels and messengers from mankind. Allah yastafi min al-malaikati rusula wa min al-nas. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala chooses from the angels messengers and from mankind. But Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala specifically made the messengers from mankind so that it is easier for us to imitate them. We can relate to them in all our affairs. And that's how the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was. He was one that in all his affairs we can relate to him, and he can relate to everyone, jalla fi ula, male and female alike, young and old. Every part of the society can relate to the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. He's an example for them. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Certainly the Messenger Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is the best example for those who are seeking Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala on the last day and remember Allah Azza wa Jal often. Those are the ones who the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he is the example that they follow. Rather, the test of your love for Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, it is based on this. Following the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. The more you love Allah, the more you follow the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam.
قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ قُلْ أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْكَافِرِينَ.
Allah says, say to them, O Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, if you truly love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, follow me, يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ, Allah Azza wa Jal will love you. That's how you attain the love of Allah Azza wa Jal. The love of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, you attain it through following the guidance of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam and imitating him. That shows that you truly love Allah, and in response Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will love you. Look, fadl azim. And not only that, Allah will forgive your sins. Allah has the most forgiving, the most merciful. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was one who came with the best guidance in all his affairs. And in everything he did it in the best manner because he was being guided by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala protected the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam from making any mistakes when it came to the message. Infallible. Delivered in the best manner. Rather, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he tells us that his sunnah, it is revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal.
وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ.
He does not speak from his whims and desires. Rather, what he utters, it is revelation that's revealed to him, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was in Mecca, before prophethood, he was known for his great character, his truthfulness, his trustworthiness, alayhi salatu wasalam. All of Quraysh, all the Arabs, they knew him for that. to the extent that when the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he was sent as a messenger, as a prophet. He was made a prophet, a messenger. He called his people, Quraysh, to Islam. When Allah تبارك وتعالى revealed, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he went to Mount Safa. He ascended it. And he cried out to all of Quraysh, calling them. They're thinking there's something great that's happened. Something important. We must go. They all congregated, gathered to hear what's happened. What's this news that we're going to be told? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he said to them, if I was to inform you now that there is an army behind this valley coming to invade you, are you going to believe me? They said, of course. You are the trustworthy, the truthful one. ما جربنا عليك كذبا. We have never known you to lie. And then he said to them, عليه الصلاة والسلام, verily I am the warner from Allah تبارك وتعالى to you, warning you of the punishment of Allah تبارك وتعالى. Say لا إله إلا الله, you'll be successful. When he said that, his uncle Abu Lahab was the first one to respond negatively. Before they were saying, you're the most truthful, the trustworthy one. He used his character, his CV, as evidence of his prophethood. Because if you think of this logically, someone who's never ever lied to a human being, never ever been known to deceive people, lie to them, trick them, always known as truthful and trustworthy. No one could come out and claim that he's ever lied to them, ever tricked them, ever deceived them, ever betrayed them. All of a sudden, does it make sense that someone all of a sudden who has never lied to a human being lies about Allah? That makes no sense. But because of their arrogance, they rejected it. His uncle Abu Lahab was the first one. He said, تَبَّلْ لَكَ سَعْرَ الْيَوْمَ لِهَذَا جَمَعْتَنَا. May you perish, he said. Did you gather us for this reason? What did the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام do? Did he respond? Huh? Did he respond to his uncle Abu Lahab after he said that? Yes or no? Yes? No? Which one? Huh? You want to call a friend? No, he didn't. He kept quiet because wisdom dictates that. If he was to respond to his uncle, what would have happened? They would have said, what kind of prophet or messenger talks back to his uncle who's more senior than him? Disrespectful, they would have said. It would have harmed the message, right? Rather, he remained silent, alayhi salatu wasalam, from his great wisdom, his character. And when you remain silent for the sake of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Allah Azza wa defends those who believe. Inna Allah yudafi'u anil ladina amanu. Allah says, verily Allah, he defends those who believe. Who responded? Allah responded from the heavens to Abu Lahab. Tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tab. ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كثب سيصلى نارا ذات لهب. Allah said, may the hands of Abu Lahab perish. They will perish. He's going to perish in the punishment. His wealth and his offspring did not benefit him. He will be thrown into a fire that has a lahab. You know what lahab means? Huh? It means what? It means a blaze. He was called Abu Lahab, right? It was a name that he was proud of. Do you guys know why? Any idea why he was called Abu Lahab? They say the reason why he was called Abu Lahab, the father of a blaze, yani a blazing fire, it is because he had extremely red cheeks. His cheeks were very red. And the Arabs, they considered this a sign of being handsome, when he had very red cheeks. So they used to call him Abu Lahab because he had fiery cheeks. He was proud of this name. But what happened? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala insulted him with a name that he was proud of. سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ. He will be thrown into a fire that has a blaze. His actual name, Abu Lahab, was Abdul Uzza. It's a name of shirk. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala didn't mention his actual name in the Quran, because Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala would never affirm shirk in the Quran. But what happened? Abu Lahab, when Surah Al-Masad was revealed, did he hear it or not? He heard it, right? What did he say? He said, Muhammad yahjuna. He said, Muhammad, he's insulting us with his poetry. Him and his wife, that's what they said.
Rather, his wife, Jamil, she went to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, looking for him. She wanted to get revenge. See, if she went to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he's with Abu Bakr. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam sitting there. Abu Bakr is sitting right next to him. She walks in, she's looking for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. She can't see him. Allah prevented her from being able to see him. She said, Abu Bakr, where's your companion? Huh? And she used to call him alayhi salatu wasalam mudhammam, which is the opposite of Muhammad. Muhammad is the praised one. Mudhammam is the dispraised one. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, he used to say, look at this. Look at the mindset of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, the best. She would go around insulting him and saying mudhammam and making poetry to insult him. He would say, yasubbuna mudhammam wa ana Muhammad. They're insulting mudhammam and I'm Muhammad. Yani, who's this mudhammam that they're insulting? Huh? She came in, she's looking for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. She can't see him. Where's your companion? Have you heard what she's saying about me? She's saying to Abu Bakr. Huh? And then after she left in her frustration. But there's something that stands out here that perhaps we don't pay attention to. You know, Allah mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Al-Masad, that Abu Lahab and his wife, they are both destined for the hellfire. Right? This is one of the chapters of the Quran that proves the Quran is the only speech of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Why? Because Allah prophesied that Abu Lahab and his wife are going to enter the hellfire whilst they were alive. Now, anyone who's not truthful in their message, they would never challenge anyone with something that they can't be sure of, right? No one would challenge anyone and say that this is going to be your fate when they can't determine your fate. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam would not take that risk for his message. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala prophesied that Abu Lahab and his wife are going to enter the hellfire. Abu Lahab could have easily turned around and said, I'm Muslim. His wife could have said, I'm Muslim. But they never did. And they died upon their disbelief. And the Quran specified that they're in the hellfire. It indicates that this is the only speech of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Jalla fi ula. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala responded on behalf of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam to his uncle in the Quran. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used his great character and his truthfulness and his past as the evidence for his message. Now look at something else. Abu Sufyan radiyallahu anhu ardah, before he embraced Islam, he went to Hiraqil, the king of the Romans. Hiraqil, he summoned Abu Sufyan and the group that are with him. And he asked them about this messenger that has appeared in Arabia. He told him, describe him to me. Now Abu Sufyan, he's the arch enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that time. But what did he say? He said he's the most truthful amongst us, the most trustworthy. He's from a great lineage. He is one who's calling us to keeping ties with the kin and aiding those who are oppressed and not oppressing others and all that which is virtuous. He asked, Hiraqil asked Abu Sufyan, have you fought him? They said, yes, we have fought him. He said, how are the battles between you? He said, Al-harb bayna sijal. Sometimes we win, sometimes he wins. Right? Hiraqil, who was a Christian, he said, this is the sign of the prophets and the messengers. He knew that from the scriptures. Now notice something else here. Abu Sufyan, who's the enemy of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, if I was your enemy and I don't like you, what am I going to say about you? Only bad things, negative things, because I hate you. But Abu Sufyan could not find a single negative thing to say about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, despite being his arch enemy. This is how the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu arda, he says that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he looked at the hearts of all of the creation, and he found the heart of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam to be the purest, so he chose him for his message and prophethood. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he looked at the hearts of the rest of the creation, and he found that the hearts of the Sahaba were the best after that, so he made them his companions and his ministers. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose the Messenger alayhi salatu because he's the best of creation. And Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi, he mentions ijma' upon that. That the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he's khayru khalqillah, the best of creation. better than Jannah. Because Jannah is the creation of Allah, right? The Messenger is better than it. He's the best creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But look at the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is khayru khalqillah, right? An A'rabi Bedouin. He approached the Messenger, alayhi salatu wa sallam. He said to him, Ya khayr al-bariyah. Oh, best of mankind. How did the Messenger, alayhi salatu wa sallam, he had to respond? He said, Dhaak akhi Ibrahim. He said, that's my brother Ibrahim, not me. Even though he's the best of creation. Humility. He's the one who said, do not go overboard with me, just like the Christians went overboard with Isa alayhi salam, Isa ibn Maryam. He's the one who will be sitting with his companions, and a man walked in and he saw the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he got startled. And then the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, Hawin alayki ya akhi, innama ana ibn imra'atin kana ta'kulu al-qadida fi Makkah. He said, calm down, oh my brother. I am the son of a woman who used to eat the dry meat in Mecca. Humility. He's showing that I'm not from a household of money and wealth. Simple household like you and me. We're the same. Humility, alayhi salam, even though he's better than every single one of them. But he was the most humble. Despite all the virtues that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala granted him. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala making the best. He's extremely humble. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How was a day in the life of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam? So that we can have a day like the day of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. We're going to mention a few things. Because the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, his days were great days. Especially when the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam was in Medina. Because when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Medina, he was everything. What do I mean by that? He is the ruler. He is the ministers. He is the judge. He is the imam of the masjid. He is the teacher. He is the husband. He is the father. He is everything. So imagine, whilst having all these different responsibilities, you can imagine how busy he was, alayhi salatu wasalam. But his day was extremely fruitful. And extremely beneficial. Not a moment went past except that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam benefited from it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would sleep at night. And he would sleep, but his heart would be awake, as we have in hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha in Bukhari. And his body would rest, but his heart would be awake. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would sleep. And then he would wake up the last third of the night. When he wakes up the last day of the night, he would pray the night prayer until his feet will swell. In Hadith of Hudhayfah radiallahu anhu, he said, I prayed to the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam one night, Qiyamul Layl. I joined him, he was praying, I just joined him. Then he recited the Surah Al-Fatiha. After Fatiha, he started with Alif Lam Mim. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون. He started to Surah Al-Baqarah. He kept going. Hudhayfa, he said, I thought to myself, he's going to go halfway, then he's going to do ruku'. He said, he got to halfway, he carried on. Then he said, Hudhayfa said, I said to myself, he's going to finish the juz, then he's going to do ruku'. He got to the juz, he carried on. Then Hudhayfa said to himself, okay, he is going to get to the end of the surah and then he's going to do ruku'. He finished Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. Ali Imran started. Afwan, in the riwayah actually he started Nisa first. He started Nisa and then Ali Imran. He went opposite. He starts Surah An-Nisa, he starts An-Nisa. Hudhayfa is thinking, He's, what's he going to do next? And then Ali Imran, all in one unit, alayhi salatu wasalam. That was his ibadah, his worship. Was he required to do that? Did he have to do that? Did he need to do that? No. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala had forgiven all his sins. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala had promised him paradise. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is going to accept all his deeds. He doesn't have to do extra. But he is doing that because he is a grateful slave to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Rather, he alayhi salatu salam, he understands and he comprehends that this is where he is going to gain strength. Ibadah. Because Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, at the beginning of the message, he said to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhal muzzammil, qumi al-layla illa qaneela, nisfahu awinqus minhu qaneela, awzida alayhi warattinil qur'ana tartila. Allah said in these verses, oh you who's covered up. This is at the beginning of the da'wah. Stand the night in prayer, except a little. Majority night pray, or half of it, or decrease, or increase, and recite the Quran proportion. Don't rush. All of this, why? Allah tells the reason.
Inna sanulqi alayka qawlan thaqila.
Allah says, certainly we are going to reveal to you heavy speech, the Quran. Allah is going to reveal this Quran to you, and your duty is, O Muhammad, that you convey it. You have a huge task tomorrow. The Quran is going to be revealed to you. You have to convey it to others. You have to teach it to others. However, tonight don't sleep. Pray. What does that teach us? That it is ibadah where you gain strength. That is what increases your strength. And the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he knew that and he understood that. So he would stand the majority of nights praying to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, because that is what gave him the ability to convey this message, to fulfill his responsibilities in the day. Alayhi salatu salam. And then after he would finish praying, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would rest for a little bit before Salat al-Fajr. And he will seek forgiveness from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, as Allah says, وَبِلْ أَسْحَارِهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. And in the early times before Hajr, they seek forgiveness, يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. That's the believers, righteous slaves of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. He would engage in that, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then the adhan for Fajr would be called. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make his way to the masjid. And when he gets to the masjid after salat, after the adhan of Fajr, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pray the sunnah of Fajr. And this Sunnah prayer, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he never ever abandoned it. His safari wal hadar. Whilst traveling or being a resident, he always observed it. Why do we say whilst traveling? Because when you're traveling, you are excused for not praying the sunan. And you will still get the reward for them, even if you don't pray them, if you used to pray them when you're a resident. But the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, there are two voluntary prayers he never abandoned. Whilst traveling or if he was resident. The sunnah before Fajr, and Salat al-Witr. He never abandoned alayhi salatu wasalam. So who would pray the sunnah of Fajr? Aisha radiallahu anha, she says that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he would recite in the sunnah of Fajr after Fatiha, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ in the first raka'a. In the second raka'a, after Fatiha, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد. The majority of times. Because he would start the day with Tawheed. These two surahs, what do they talk about? Tawheed, the oneness of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. He's starting the day with that. And it's reported the Messenger alayhi salam, when he was traveling, he recited Suratul Zalzala in the Sunnah of Fajr in both rak'as. إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا. And it's reported also in the Sunnah of Fajr, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, sometimes he would recite in both rak'ahs only Suratul Fatiha. All this is from the Sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. But the Sunnah is to do each one sometimes, not stick to one all the time, like the Messenger alayhi salam would do. And the majority of the time it would be قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ and قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد. That's the majority. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. After praying Salat, the Sunnah of Fajr, they would pray Salat al-Fajr. And this is the longest obligatory prayer of the day. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would lengthen Salatul Fajr. Would make it long. Because the Salah, the obligatory prayers, they are long in the order that they're in. The longest is Fajr. Then Dhuhr, then Asr, then Maghrib, then Isha. And sometimes the Prophet alayhi wa sallam would make Maghrib shorter than Isha. Right? But generally that's how the length is of the Salawat. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would lengthen the Salah and he would take his time. And how was he alayhi salatu wasalam when he'd be praying? The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they would report that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was reciting the Quran out loud, that sometimes he would be overwhelmed by the ayat and he would start crying sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And they would hear a buzz coming from his chest because he's concealing, he's trying to hold in the cries sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Because the Quran, it would of course affect him. And it would affect the Sahaba who were hearing it. Because this Quran, they understood it properly. And because they understood it, it had a great impact on their lives. And they were moved by it immediately. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after Salat al-Fajr, he would turn around to his companions. He would recite his adhkar of Salah. And then the morning adhkar al-Sabah. After reciting Adhkar al-Sabah, the Sahaba all sitting there, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would speak to the Sahaba and he would ask them, who has seen a dream last night? If someone saw a dream, he'll tell them if it's a good narrator to us and he'll interpret the dreams for them. Sometimes they would talk about matters from their past and this shows that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he combined between the spiritual aspect and the social aspect. Because if you are only focused on the spiritual aspect, the nafs, the soul, naturally it becomes bored or it becomes tired. So he would diversify alayhi salatu wasalam so that they are constantly energetic for ibadah. Sometimes he alayhi salatu wasalam will give them a reminder. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, and in the hadith of Bara ibn Azib, he said, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam kan yatakhawwaluna bil maw'idah. He would give us reminders sometimes. Not all the time, always giving reminder, lecture. What happens if you keep being giving lecture like I'm doing? You get bored. Saying, when is he going to stop talking? La ilaha illallah. He talks too much. But the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he would give the reminder when it was the most appropriate time, the most suitable time, because of wisdom alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's why, what does that teach us? That it is not befitting that one, he always is trying to give a lecture. He's always trying to give a reminder to the people and so on. That is not from the guidance of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Rather, you do it in the suitable times and places. For instance, sometimes you'll go to a wedding. It's a happy occasion. People are celebrating a new family. And then you find someone, mashallah, after the wedding, he wants to give a lecture. He wants to talk for 1 hour. I went to a wedding one time. Someone did that. I think it was just before the Aqd Nikah happened. He was giving long lecture. Right? And people, they want the Nikah to happen quickly. They want to celebrate. They want to enjoy the occasion. He's giving long lecture. And it's not even a lecture that perhaps captivates people. He's talking about ahkam, rules and regulations. This is not the time to talk about rules and regulations, huh? So the people, what do? They got fed up, they started clapping. Yeah, Sheikh, hurry up. Some started hitting their plates. We're hungry. This is going against the guidance of the Messenger alayhi salam. What does that do? That repels people from knowledge and listening to the mu'izah. It makes them dislike it because you are constantly bombarding them with that. But the Messenger alayhi salam, he would not do that. Sometimes you do, sometimes you talk to them about normal stuff, have conversations with people. Right? And perhaps when you are having genuine conversations with people, you can teach them more than just talking to them and lecturing them. Tayyib. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would remain in the masjid until the sun would rise, normally. And he would pray Salatul Duha. Salat al-Duha, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he told us what it is. He told us it is Salatul Awwabin, the prayer of those who constantly return to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And he told us in a hadith alayhi salatu wasalam that every single day that the son of Adam, he wakes up, every joint in his body, there is sadaqah that he needs to give for every joint. How many joints do we have in our body? 360 joints you need to give sadaqah for them every day that you wake up. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he told us that every time you say subhanallah, that is sadaqah, alhamdulillah sadaqah, la ilaha illallah sadaqah for you, enjoining good, forbidding evil, sadaqah. He mentioned many things, but then he mentioned alayhi salatu wasalam that praying two rak'ahs of duha, it is sufficient. It gives charity for every joint in your body. Allahu Akbar. The Messenger alayhi salam would observe this and he would highly encourage it. So it's upon us to engage in that and to observe it as well, like the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he would do. Tayyib. After that, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would go back to his home and he would, in the hadith, it's found that he would not go back to sleep after that time. The day would start. Morning, khalas, day has started. And the day has started, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will engage in the responsibilities that he needs to fulfill until Salat al-Dhuhr. Once Salat al-Dhuhr will come, the Messenger alayhi wa sallam will be in the masjid. And he will lead the Sahaba in the prayer. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's from his sunnah that he would renew his wudu for all the salawat sometimes, even if he had wudu, sunnah. He would renew his wudu alayhi salatu wasalam, he would lead the sahaba in salah. And salat al-dhuhr, he would make it long, standing for long, the recitation. To the extent the sahaba radiallahu anhum, they would say one of us would leave, who would go make wudu, who would finish making wudu, he would slowly walk back to the masjid. As he's walking to the masjid and he's taking his time, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is still in the first rak'ah. In our masajid, if I went during after the Takbirat al-Ihram, if I went to go make wudu, perhaps I'll come back and the Imam is in the fourth rak'ah. It happens in some masajid, right? Very fast. One masjid that I went to, the Imam, he says, and one time I went there and I found it very strange, the salat was very quick. So the Imam was asked, why do you make it very quick? It's very fast. He said, yeah, Sheikh, look, this masjid is surrounded by shops and businesses. All the people who come to my masjid are businessmen. They don't have time. Money is waiting. So they've given me only 5 minutes to lead them in salah. If I add 1 minute, I'm in trouble. Another example that I remember, it is that one time the Imam, there was an Imam, he was leading the salah in the masjid. And the jama'ah, they're all praying with him. He is leading a 4 rak'ah salah. When he got to the 3rd rak'ah, he sat for tashahud, the last tashahud. No one said anything. He sat, he finished tashahud. He did taslim. Salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum. 3 rak'ahs he led them, not 4 rak'ahs. No one said a word. He turned around. No one said anything. All of a sudden, one of the guys at the back, he stood up. He said, yeah, Imam, you led us only 3 rak'ahs. It was not 4. He said, Wama yudrik, how do you know? He said, yeah, Sheikh, shuf. When I join your salah, I have 4 shops. The first rak'ah, I count everything in the first shop. Second rak'ah, second shop. Third rak'ah, third shop. I didn't get to the 4th shop, ya Sheikh. We have 1 rak'ah to finish. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Allah musta'an, ya nusiba. It shows how absent-minded we are in the salah, that not a single person that mentions it even realized that they prayed 3 rak'ahs. And the one who realized, he realized because of dunya. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Allah musta'an. So the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he would lengthen the salah. And the sahaba, they would enjoy it. Salat al-Asr is a bit shorter. But throughout the day now, we're in daytime, right? The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he'd be walking around the market. He'd be walking around amongst the people. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be with the Sahaba. A lot of the time, he's accompanied by Sahaba. And as he's walking with the Sahaba, one day, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was walking with a group of the Sahaba, an old woman and a young boy who were standing together, they stopped the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. The old woman, she said to the Prophet alayhi salam, Ya Rasulallah, li ilayka haja. I have a request. This old woman, she was not any ordinary old woman. She was a very old woman who was a slave woman. She said, Oh Messenger of Allah, I have a request. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he stopped. And then she started to tell the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam about her whole life story, yani. For ages. And you can imagine the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he's very busy. If I'm very busy, what time am I going to say? Allah, quickly, and I have appointment to get to. Get to the point. La. She went on and on. He didn't interrupt her once. He listened. Until she had finished. After she had finished, what did he say, alayhi salatu wasalam? Look at this. He said, Here I am. Take me to any of the streets of Medina you wish to help you with your request. So what would she do? Is it? She said. Khalas. She took him to the market to help her with shopping, to check out her master, to intercede for her, everywhere. It's an opportunity, huh? Rasulullah is with you. He said, take me wherever you like. That's how the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam was. He was one who was accessible to the whole society. Approachable. Anyone who needed assistance, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would aid them. He didn't think that I'm above that. Rather, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just like that, he would give time to the children. And he had the best character with the children. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was served by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu wa aradah for 10 years, serving the Messenger alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now look at the statement of Anas, what he says. He says, I served the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam for 10 years. And he never ever said to me during those 10 years, why did he do that? Why did he not do that? He never ever told me off. 10 years, imagine. When someone's working with you, naturally, they're going to do things wrong. Naturally, things are going to go wrong. You might ask, why did he do that? Why did he not do that? But the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he never ever did that. Subhanallah. From his character. Great character. That he wouldn't be one who constantly reprimanded children. And that is bad tarbiyah, by the way, for parents to do. That you're constantly telling your child off. Because if you're one who is always telling your child off, what happens when you actually are serious about the matter, they don't take it seriously. Because they're like, he's always like this anyway. What makes today special? But if you're one who rarely reprimands his children or tells them off or rebukes them, occasionally when it's a serious matter, then that matter will be taken extremely serious. But every day you're moaning, every day you're shouting, every day you're screaming, then khalas, your screams and your shouts and all this will not be taken seriously. Rather, it will get to a stage where it will not have an effect on the child. It's not the way to nurture the children. Rather, it's the opposite. That you're one who reasons with the child. You speak to them. You help them try to understand. Because if you try to speak to the child as a dumb child, then they'll be dumb. If you treat them as dumb, then they'll behave as if they're dumb. Even though they're more intelligent. But he says to my parents, they think I'm dumb. Khalas, I'll be dumb. So you're the one who molds him into who they are. And that's how the Messenger alayhi salam was. He spoke to the children as if they were adults. He nurtured them, educated them as if they were adults. To the extent that one day the Prophet alayhi salam, he did hijama. After he did hijama, Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhuma, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he gave him blood that came out of him and he told him, dispose of it, Ya Abdullah. So he said, okay. Now Abdullah is a child at the time. He took the blood, he went away. What did he do with it? He drank it. But the Prophet alayhi salatu, everything comes out in barakah, by the way. It's different. He's not like everyone else. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, his barakah is muta'addiyah. It extends to others. Whereas everyone else is not like that. Right? Their barakah that they may have is lazima, it sticks to them. But the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, his barakah was muta'addiyah, extended to others. So the Sahaba would take barakah from everything the Messenger alayhi salam would come from him. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he took the blood, he drank it. He came back to the Messenger alayhi salam, he said, got rid of it. He said, what do you do with it? He went quiet. The Prophet alayhi salam, did you drink it? He went silent. The Messenger alayhi salam realized that he drank it. He said to his father, Zubayr ibn Awam, radiallahu anhu, he said, your son, this one, he's going to have a great future. He's going to be from the most courageous men amongst the Arabs that they have ever seen. And that was the case. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he was a family man. And he took care of his family. He would attend to their needs. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would assist his family in the household. He would help them with what they need. And he would say alayhi salatu wasalam, khayrukum khayrukum li ahlihi wa ana khayrukum li ahli. The best of you are those who are the best to their families and wives. And I'm the best amongst you to their families and wives. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was forbearing with the harm that came from his family. Sometimes, you know, the family, they can annoy you, right? One day the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he had some guests over in the house of Aisha radiallahu anha. Zainab, who was Aisha's biggest threat and biggest competition, she found out the Messenger alayhi salatu, he has guests. What did she do? She prepared some food and then she gave it to her servant to take it to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam's house, in Aisha's house. Yani, what is Zainab doing? Zainab is basically saying, Aisha can't cook for the guests. I have to help the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The servant brings the dish, brings it to Aisha's house. The Prophet alayhi salam takes it, gives it to Aisha. Aisha, she finds out who it came from. What did she do? She looked at it. She didn't say anything. She smashed it in front of the guests. The house is very small, by the way. She smashed the whole plate. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, how do you think he reacted? His guests are shocked. They're thinking, Yani, what just happened? Have we just walked into a war zone? But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting there calm, like nothing had happened. And then he looked up at the Sahaba and then he realized they're confused. He said, Gharat ummukum, your mother has become jealous. And he carried on as if nothing has happened. Now imagine you, that was you. Huh? And you had guests in the house. And then your wife, she got angry, she smashed everything. What would you do? You become angry. You embarrass me in front of my guest. How dare you, huh? You'd probably lose it. Allah understand, divorced. He might get to that. He divorced. Go to your father's house. Maybe, right? But the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, look how calm he was. Try to put yourselves in that situation. Because it may sound great and wonderful when it's from the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, but imagine you were there. How would you react it? That's where the test is, right? The test is to imitate the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. It is to develop that, to teach yourself to be like that in all your affairs, right? And just like that, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when it came to his family, he was one who honored his family. He would spend time with his wives and he would sit with them, he would chat with them and so on. And they would tell him stories like we have in the hadith of Zara'a, the hadith of Aisha, right? Where Aisha, she tells the Messenger alayhi salam about women who gathered and they spoke about their husbands and they said that they're going to speak the truth about their husbands. She tells the Messenger alayhi salam the long story. Huh? If it was you, you would have fallen asleep. Woman talk, you're already asleep, huh? But the Messenger alayhi salam, he listened to her and he's responding to her. And he said to her at the end of the hadith, when she praised Zara'a's husband, Abu Zara'a, right? Zara'a, she said that my husband Abu Zara'a is the best husband. She praised him, etc. But then at the end, she mentioned that he divorced her. Right, he married someone else. Even though she's praising him so much. And the Messenger alayhi salam, he said to Aisha, after listening to the whole story, he said to her, I am to you like Abu Zara'a was to Zara'a. And then he added the end in some riwayat, غَيْرَ أَنِّي لَا أُطَلِّقْ, except that I won't divorce you. Right? He listened to the whole story alayhi salatu wasalam. Who has the patience nowadays to listen to all their stories? They want someone who just listens. Ah, nod your head. In agreement. If you do too often, they realize you're not listening. Sometimes do this. It yani balances out. Sometimes say, oh, no way. Wow, I didn't realize. Oh, subhanAllah, the sisters are here. Ah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. we are in trouble.
and what do you call it? Al-Muhandis Ibrahim streaming live, huh? Khalas, we are in trouble. I am in trouble now. My secret has been exposed to the whole world. I'm joking. One of the ulama, he said, when my wife, well, he said, when your wife, she gets angry with you, right? She gets angry with you. Well, I don't think I should say this. I might get in trouble as well. I'll skip this one. Maybe another time. But it was a funny one. طيب. The Messenger, alayhi salatu salam, he was with his wife, Khadija, radiallahu anha, who is married to her for 25 years. 25 years that he was married to Khadija, radiallahu anha. He, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he never, ever, ever, ever argued with Khadija. Never had a disagreement. 25 years. Their voices were never raised in the house, ever. Jibreel alayhi salam, one day he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he said to him that Khadija radiallahu anha, she's going to come to you. She's going to come to you with a bowl of soup. When she comes to you, inform her that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is giving her salam, and that I am giving her salam. And then give her glad tidings of a palace in Jannah. لا صخب فيه ولا نصب. He said that there's no noise in it and no illness and fatigue. Now, why did he specify noise? Because in the household of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام Mecca, there was never ever noise with Khadija رضي الله عنها. الجزاء من جنس العمل. So she gets rewarded for that. A palace in Jannah, no noise in it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he loved Khadija. She was the most beloved to him. And that was no secret, by the way. He made it very clear, as much as possible, to the extent that even after she passed away, he would always be mentioning her every time he remembered her. Every time he would slaughter meat, a portion of that meat he would gift it to the friends of Khadija radiallahu anha. Out of wafa'a to Khadija radiallahu anha wa ardaha. To the extent that every time he would remember Khadija radiallahu anha after her death, he would praise her to the extent that Aisha and other wives, they'll get jealous. One day Aisha radiallahu anha, she goes so jealous, she says, Ya Rasulallah, why is it that you keep mentioning this toothless old woman? Hasn't Allah tabarak wa ta'ala replaced her with something better than her? She means herself. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no. She was taken back by that. And then he said, she believed in me when no one believed in me. She aided me and supported me with everything she had and her wealth when everyone left me. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala granted me children from her. And he went on to praise her. Aisha radiallahu anha regretted even saying that because he went to praise her even more. Every time he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would receive guests. If he received the guests, one day a guest knocked on the door. And he realized and noticed who the voice was. And he got happy, alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, Allahumma hala. Oh Allah, let it be hala. Yani, who's hala? The sister of Khadija radiallahu anha. She reminded him of Khadija radiallahu anha. Right? That's how he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he would say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inni ruziqtu hubbaha. The love of Khadija, it is embedded in me. He was never shy of mentioning that, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he was known to everyone. That's how the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was with his wife, with his children. The majority of the children of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, all of them, they passed away in his lifetime except Fatima. Now, let's try to put this into perspective. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he lost both of his parents as a child. He never met his father. His mother died at the age of 6. He lost his grandfather at the age of 8. He, alayhi salatu salam, was raised by his uncle. He eventually got married. He had children. Every single one of his children, they died whilst he's alive. Now, just losing one child can make a parent go insane. Imagine 6 children dying in your lifetime, subhanAllah, and burying them yourself. And the Messenger, alayhi salatu salam, despite all those difficulties that he went through, he was still able to smile. He was still able to be positive, optimistic. He never let any challenge change that. Because he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he
He is aware of the great reward of Allah Tabarak, he knows it. That this world, this is nothing, and the hereafter, it is greater. And that is what he is looking forward to, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, he was one who taught the society with rahmah, with mercy. And he educated them. Those who made mistakes, if they didn't know better, he would teach them. Those who knew better, he would be harsh with them so that he would reprimand them. Those who were new to Islam, he would attract them to Islam by giving them gifts and welcome them and so on. And he, alayhi salatu wasalam, he would constantly use every opportunity he can to educate the Sahaba radiallahu anhu on the matters of their deen. Extremely keen in doing so. And because of all these acts that the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, he did, he managed to produce a great generation, the best generation of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa. They all graduated from the Masjid of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That's where they graduated from. And then they went out to the world and spread this message of Islam to the world, which reached us. So we ask Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala to make us from those who follow the guidance of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala to forgive us. And we ask Allah Azza wa to have mercy upon us. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala to make us from those who learn about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala to make us from those who live upon his sunnah and die upon it, and resurrect us with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and unite us in Jannah with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, innahu wali dhalika al-qadir alayhi. Jazakumullah.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wasalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam ajma'in. And I want to say to Sheikh Yahya, jazahullahu khair al-jazah, on your behalf, mashallah, for that beautiful talk and lecture. And we want to say to you, Ustazana Yahya, Jazakallah Khair for coming. And as you can see, look at the attendance, mashallah, how many brothers, parents, youngsters, mashallah. And mashallah, brothers from everywhere, mashallah, alhamdulillah, and who have attended the lecture. You can see, mashallah, the congregation, the masjid, the community, how much they love you when they know that, when they find out that you're coming, alhamdulillah, they come. And they would like to benefit from you. So, Jazakallah Khairan. I just want to say to you, like the Prophet ﷺ has said about Jabal Uhud, Jabal Uhud, Jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbuhu. So, what we're going to say to Ustaz Yahya is, Ustaz Yahya yuhibbuna wa nahnu nuhibbuhu. MashaAllah. He loves us and we love him as well. Like the Prophet ﷺ has said, Jabal Uhud, the mountain of Uhud, loves us and we love the mountain of Uhud. So, MashaAllah, that's why we like to invite you very, mashallah, so often. And alhamdulillah, you always accept our invitation. So, Jazakallah Khair. And now Sheffield is beginning to kind of like, so they're getting to know you now because you went to Masjid al-Taqwa. The Grand Mosque invited you right now. Other masajids will be inviting you. So, alhamdulillah, the twin cities, the city of Manchester and the city of Sheffield, alhamdulillah, the twin masajids, mashallah, Masjid al-Furqan and Masjid al-Taqwa. So, alhamdulillah, we have that special bond, alhamdulillah, and we'll be soon visiting you in London, inshallah ta'ala. So, jazakumullah khair. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make your journey back to London safe one, inshallah ta'ala. And we would like to thank Brother Ubaid one more time, mashallah, for coming to Masjid al-Furqan for the first time, inshallah ta'ala. It won't be the last time. Ustaz Ubaid, am I right? Your first visit, inshallah. Barakallah fiqh, jazakallah khair. So barakallah fiqhum to all the brothers, mashallah, and the sisters who've attended the talk. I want to also thank our media team for doing the, mashallah, an amazing work. Mashallah, our Muhandis Ibrahim, and mashallah, and his team as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them greatly. Jazakumullah khair. Give salam to the Sheikh, inshallah ta'ala, before you leave. Mashallah, give him some love. Give him some love, inshallah.